So we just finished the discussion around the other minerals, and we've come to what I think is the most brilliant part of HMA, which is the metabolic typing system that you have developed. Tell me about how that came about and how you, how you think about the metabolic typing.
Well, I guess, you know, many years ago, back in college, and then even in clinical practice, I was always a fan of using natural therapies, nutritional therapies, and so forth. And but I would find that my patient's response varied so greatly that I felt I wasn't able to address their individual need. And of course, back then, I believe we were more in tune, you know, we're going back 40 years here, we were more in tune even through nutritional therapy of treating conditions and not the person. In other words, we had a set regime for a person who came into the office. If they had arthritis, then we would give them a certain set of nutrients. If they had heart conditions, we'd give them certain nutrients, diabetes, certain nutrients, and some would respond, some wouldn't, some would get worse. And of course, the test that we had available to us then didn't necessarily show us the causation there. In some cases it would, but you know, the typical blood tests, urine tests, they weren't necessarily showing any major abnormalities you know, relative to their condition. So I was trying to get more of a specific indication of a person's need. And back in the day, I read books by Roger Williams, who, you know, he wrote Metabolic Individuality back in the 40s, I believe it was. And then other individuals had written, Dr. Page at the Page Foundation, he looked at people based on sympathetic, parasympathetic dominance. And then George Watson, back in the 70s, he wrote a book called Nutrition in the Mind, where he was discussing the psychological makeup or the psychological manifestations, abnormal manifestations in individuals who had different oxidation types. You know, so there was a good basis for you know, the fact that metabolic individuality existed. And as a matter of fact, I'd like to show this. This is just interesting. It's not going to be very clear on the camera, but this is something that came out of Dr. Roger Williams' book. And if you can see it, it's just basically a, it looks like a human here with a head.
A robot.
And arms. Yeah, it looks like a robot. And basically each one of those squares represents a test. For example, the head is glucose. The body or the abdomen is amylase and lactic acid and so on. So these are each one of these segments is a blood test with the normal range for that blood test. So, and then he took 11 individuals, young, athletic, supposedly healthy individuals, and he ran fasting tests on these individuals every, once a week for a period of 6 weeks to do every one of these tests. And so what this icons, these icons are showing are the differences in the individuals of those tests. And so he basically made the you know, the squares different based upon the ranges that they found. And you can see quite a difference there on those icons as far as the ranges of the blood range. But so anyway, he was a big inspiration, Dr. Roger Williams, on recognizing the individuality of people and their metabolic individuality. But still, there was no way to really test it. You could do questionnaires and get some idea, and body types, body structure, you could get some idea, but it wouldn't tell you exactly their need. You could put them in a category like a type A or type B individual, or the apple shape and the pear-shaped body structure, but it still would not give you the individual need. And so that's when we started looking at hair mineral analysis. At first, it did not necessarily jump out at you as far as what these results meant. And but I looked at the hair mineral patterns to individual patients with various diseases, and then I was able to do various tests, you know, blood tests, urine tests, and so forth, and again, physical exams and that type of thing. And so slowly, you know, we were able to start seeing that there's patterns here, and some people have that are susceptible to certain diseases, like many people with heart conditions, they had a certain pattern. People with arthritic conditions, they had a certain pattern, and
right,
so forth. And
right.
so eventually, over the years, and we're still learning, you know, more and more, but over the years, we're able to start recognizing patterns, and then recognizing metabolic types from those patterns, and treating the person rather than the condition, the health condition that they have.
And we know the metabolic typing as slow 1-2-3-4 and fast 1-2-3-4.
Correct.
How did you come up with that? How did you identify those? You know, that's it's brilliant now, but how do you come up with it?
Well, basically, one of the things that Dr. Page's work produced was he found that the minerals were impacted by the nervous system.
Okay? Yeah.
And he found that by putting patients in sort of a metabolic ward and keeping them there for a week, you know, or more, and doing these various blood tests on them, and then giving them micro amounts of endocrines and so forth, hormones, you know, he was able to look at these blood shifts, you know, they would still be within the normal range, but they would shift somewhat, and the minerals I'm talking about in the blood. And he basically surmised that the mineral calcium, you know, was controlled by the parasympathetic nervous system, largely, and the mineral phosphorus was controlled by the sympathetic nervous system.
Right.
And so based on that premise, if you look at the calcium to phosphorus balance, and if the sympathetic nervous system is dominant, then a person would be dominant in phosphorus. And then if the parasympathetic dominant or slow, you know, fast or slow,
right,
if they were slow metabolic types, then calcium would be dominant. And then, so from that, looking at the calcium to phosphorus ratio as the neurological indicator, then we started looking at the endocrine indicators relative to that. And so the subtypes, like the type 1 fast and slow, those are the two major metabolic categories, and the subtypes are various stages of stress that they're undergoing. Like the slow type 2 is generally an alarm phase of stress, slow type 3 is in a resistance, and type 4 is in a chronic resistance stage of stress. And so that's sort of how we came up with the metabolic categories, the 8 types, and then we fashioned, you know, the or started looking at minerals, vitamins, foods, herbs, and how they impact that. And it's a simple concept in the sense that a fast metabolic type is overly stimulated, and so we would want to take away anything they may be taking or consuming that's highly stimulative, and put them on things that are sedative.
Right.
You know, it's just, and then those people that are overly sedated, we want to remove those, you know, like foods and so forth that sedate, and put them on foods that have a enhancing effect on their metabolic activity.
So you came up with a kind of ratio system that indicate if they're 1-2-3-4.
Yes.
Based on, you know, it seems intricate. So we are, when the patient come in, I mean, in general, you want to stimulate the sedated ones, and you want to slow down the overstimulated ones. But what is the, you know, it seems impossible to hit the exact ratio. You're just steering them in the right direction.
Right. Yeah, that's exactly right. That's a good point. You know, we're, you know, I guess, you know, we look at a chart, a mineral chart, And, you know, ideally, everything we'd want balanced all the way across here,
right.
You know, on all that, the and also the significant ratios and so forth, and all the heavy metals down low. But that's what we shoot for. We shoot for the ideal. And that's just a constant goal, though.
Yes.
And even after a person reaches a balance, you know, it doesn't mean they'll stay there.
No.
You know,
because we're influenced daily.
We're influenced daily by... Yes. Any number of things. Yeah. You know, you get married, you know, you move. These are all stressors, and it impacts our chemistry.
That's true. That's true. But, you know, we often hear, or I also tell my patients, that if you are a slow metabolic type, it may take longer to readjust or rebalance. You have to be slightly more patient. If this pattern has been in place for a while, it will take a little bit to shake them up and get them in the right direction. Is that correct?
No, that is true.
That is true.
Because usually that pattern is one that has been there for a long period of time. And I think it all depends on how long it's been there.
Mm.
You know, if we're looking at a 40-year-old person, you know, or 50, you know, and they're slow, have that slow pattern, they may have been that way for, you know, 30 years. And it can take longer. And then, plus, there is a little bit of an issue with their ability to comply. Many times, their compliance can be, you know, if it's lacking, then their response is going to be take longer.
Right.
For example, with the heavy metals or excess nutritional elements like iron or manganese, as these things become mobilized in the body, they cause symptoms. And a lot of people mistake that as worsening of their condition, but it's a normal and necessary process. For example, you know, as copper is mobilized, and if a young woman has excessive copper and it starts being mobilized, it can cause, you know, breakouts on their skin and pimples and rashes. And they may go, if they're extremely, extremely sensitive about their aesthetics, then they may, you know, get extremely upset over that and discontinue, you know, because they don't want that. And it is a necessary, I've seen that happen a lot, actually.
Yes.
And once you convince them that, well, you know, the important thing is to get rid of it so it doesn't keep recurring and recurring over time. And once they understand that and they go through it, then they're very happy. But a lot of people may not be informed of those adverse events that could occur, and they may look at it negatively as far as the response.
So it's important to prepare them that it may get worse before it gets better.
Yes, it certainly can, because a lot of these patterns are retracing. You know, not only you don't go from normal to illness, you know, just overnight. You go through these patterns to get there, and life, you go through life to get there. And all the ramifications of that is in those patterns. And so whenever you start improving, you will retrace some of those patterns that you went through throughout your life.
Yes.
And some of those can be very disconcerting and scary for a person, you know, because, you know, emotionally they may not want to reface some of those stressors that they had been through.
But I remember thinking about these things myself. If I've been, slow for 30 years or fast for 30 years or trending, for years and years, if I then change things around and having been slow for a long time and I'm able to get on the fast side of things, how long will it take before I kind of counter that long trend? Does that happen just immediately? I mean, if the hair mineral analysis tests show that I'm a fast one, is that just, do I maintain that for as many years as I was slow just to compensate and readjust things? Or am I, right there and then, I'm fast one and I don't have to worry about the 30 years of slowness?
No, you're exactly right. That's a good point. Typically, you know, if a person has been fast, let's say for 30 years, and we do a test on them when they're 40. You know, they've been, and they're slow. Okay, they've been slow for only 10 years. Well, now the trend to go back to that fast pattern is going to be much quicker than a slow who'd been, slow for 35 years.
Right.
And but once you reach it, yes, it doesn't necessarily mean you're going to stay right there. You know, because you would have to, get into that pattern for a period of time. Another interesting thing about that is when we look at body types, many times we'll see a person with an apple-shaped body structure, and you go, oh, that person's a fast. Or then we see a person with a pear-shaped body structure, and we'll say, oh, that's a slow. And it is a slow or fast pattern. But when we look at the mineral pattern, then that could be the opposite, okay?
Right.
Because the body types take time to change.
Right,
And then also the psychological changes won't necessarily go with that either. Yeah. And so you can have a person that has all the fast characteristics, even psychologically and physically, but they might be a slow, you know, they could be a burned out fast that went into slow, you know, for example. And then, but their return to that fast metabolic rate will be rather quick compared to a slow metabolic type going up into a fast.
So if I've been slow for many years and I do change things around and I end up in as fast one, that's a trustworthy condition, that's my new state, and I will then have to worry about not being too stimulative. I should calm down the stimulatory and kind of balance things out.
Right, that's a good point. You know, I guess the question is what's ideal, you know?
Yes,
and, and really, slow or fast, either category is fine. It's just not too severe into either category because, you know, what makes us human is who we are, and you know, for example, we see certain occupations having certain metabolic characteristics and metabolic types, you know, and you wouldn't necessarily want to change that because that makes them who they are. But if they get too far into the pattern, it starts causing distress and health issues, even conflicts, you know, among couples, you know, then it needs to be addressed, you know.
Yeah, you don't necessarily want to slow down Usain Bolt or
right.
You know, it's, yeah. All right. Well, I think that's an extremely interesting concept around the metabolic typing. And I'm thinking, you know, when I went on training with a Swedish therapist when I took my level 2 training in HMA, and she said, you know, the interesting thing about, you know, you get into the category 4, and you're kind of hitting the wall, but see how easy it is to move from fast 4 to slow 1 and vice versa, slow 4 into fast 1. Is that is that how you think about it too? That that's the smart, is that kind of calculated into your recommendation when you get into the 4 level, is to kind of flip them over to the other side?
Right. Yes. If that is their natural propensity, it is to do that. And you're right. See, a slow 4 is very similar to a fast 1.
Yes.
You know, and a fast 4 is very similar to a slow 1.
Yes.
You know, and so and basically. It's easy to change that, I think, compared to chronic slow metabolic rate and chronic fast metabolic rates. It's fairly easy to change that. And what we find is when a person becomes pretty well balanced here, they'll just sort of, you know, on testing them every 2 or 3 months, we've tested people for 30 years, and the people that we see that get fairly balanced, you know, we'll fluctuate a little bit back and forth between, you know, like a fast 1 to a slow 4, you know, and so on.
Yeah.
So, and that's not unusual. It's not a big jump by any means.
Yeah.
It's just a mild, subtle
just tweaking it a little
change.
Bit.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you again, Dave. I think it's very, very interesting, and you know, it must feel great to have come up with such a system that helps so many people, you know, in understanding their everyday lives.
It is exciting, and we're ever learning. And there's so much more to be learned and apply. You know, so it's a great, wonderful field to be in.
Yes. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
And,